It is a very special pleasure for me to introduce today's speaker of the physics colloquium, Thibault Damour, from the Institut des Hautes Études Scientifiques in Bure, near Paris. Thibault Damour is known for a variety of contributions, ranging from general relativity to supergravity and to string theory, and also ranging from the rather concrete and closed observation to the more speculative. For instance, in general relativity, let me mention his work on binary pulsars, which was crucial in making contact between the Nobel Prize-winning observation by Hulse and Taylor, and on one hand, and Einstein theory on the other hand. And for that purpose, Thibault had to develop novel expansion schemes valid in strong gravitational field that is well beyond the usual post-Newtonian approximations. And another topic is about inspiraling binaries and the gravitational field patterns which are associated with them, and about that we will hear today. On the more speculative side, perhaps, he's known for studying alternative theories to gravity, as for instance proposed by string theory. And the question of his is also what might ultimately replace the notion of space in quantum gravity. And the proposal of his and Hermann Nicolai is that it might be a coset space of some exceptional Lie algebra. Now, let me not dwell too much in the many prizes Thibault has received. Let me just mention one, because it's a Swiss prize. Yes. It's the Einstein Medal, which he was awarded in Bern in 1996. So before giving the word to Thibault, let me say just one more thing. So Thibault is among those quite rare people who is able to convey the grand picture, who is able to answer the question, what does it all mean, and to relate the questions of physics nowadays to the questions which have been of the questions of physics at all times. And with that, I would like you to welcome Thibault Damour to the colloquium.
Thank you. Oops. So, after these very kind words, let me start. So, it's a great pleasure to be here in Zurich, the town where Einstein contributed so much. So I want to talk about gravitational waves from coalescing binary black holes, and I want to make the connection between the analytical calculation and analytical method to compute the gravitational waves emitted by binary system and existing numerical calculations of binary black holes, and how these are two approximation schemes for solving Einstein's equations in view of detecting gravitational waves in a few years. So first, let's remind ourselves that Einstein introduced the notion of gravitational waves in basic papers of 1916 and 1918. So here you have Über Gravitationals Wellen, where he was solving Einstein's equations, here written in full, by a perturbation method. So essentially, you look for solution of Einstein's equations where the special metric is a small deviation from the Euclidean metric, and you find that there are plane wave solutions that propagate at the velocity of light in vacuum, and which are all their physical effects are transverse to the direction of propagation, and actually in the transverse plane they contain only 2 degrees of freedom because they are also traceless and transverse. So like electromagnetic waves, they are transverse and they have only 2 degrees of freedom, but these are gravitational waves. The first person who really pioneered the idea that gravitational waves could be detected, that who really thought about experiments that could see something, was Joe Weber. who at the end of the 50s and the early 60s, first he wrote a theoretical book. So he understood the theory by discussing with mathematicians, actually, he told me. But he was the first one to think that when a gravitational wave emitted by a binary system very far in the universe comes on the Earth, then what happens is that this wave changes the distance among any pairs of bodies. So if you have two bodies and the wave is coming like that, the distance between the two bodies will change in time. And actually, the fractional change in the distance, delta L over L, the fractional relative change of distance, is given by the same quantity which appeared in the previous transparency, which is the modification of the metric of space-time. Projected in the direction of the distance between the two objects. And Joe Weber thought about detecting it by using a massive cylinder, waiting for a gravitational wave to pass and to excite the longitudinal oscillation move of the cylinder. So, essentially, the theory of linearized gravitational waves is telling us that gravitational waves has two helicity states. As I said, they act only in the plane transverse to the propagation direction. So if, for instance, the wave propagates in the Z, along the Z-axis, you have components of the gravitational waves only in the XY plane, and they have two independent components in this plane. And the physical effects of the physical components is to stretch and squeeze objects in the transverse plane. Like you have a ring of particle, it can be stretched and squeezed like that transversely to the propagating gravitational wave. Now, we have not yet detected the arrival of gravitational waves on Earth, but what John Michele alluded to, which is the comparison between observations of binary pulsar data, which is the timing of binary pulsars in our galaxy as seen on the Earth, and the theory of Einstein, which predicts that that gravitational radiation damping is actually changing the orbital dynamics of these binary pulsars. The comparison, therefore, between binary pulsar data and general relativity gives a certain number of tests, and these tests, I will not describe them in detail, but in the plane, which is the plane of the two unknown masses of the pulsars, M1, let's say MA, the pulsar, and the mass MB of the companion, you make several measurements, and that gives rise to several curves, and if these curves meet at one point, then this is a confirmation that general relativity is correct. And all the curves here, they all meet at one point, like for instance this point, this point, this point, and if these curves here contain the P dot curve, this is an effect of gravitational radiation damping. So all those binary pulsars, they already prove that gravitational waves exist in our universe. And they not only that they exist, but that general relativity is valid for the description of a strongly self-gravitating object like a neutron star. So this gives us confidence to use general relativity to describe gravitational waves. Now, what is the experimental effort towards the detection of gravitational waves? The experimental effort currently is that in the world, you have several kilometer-sized detectors that exist. There are two detectors that exist in America called LIGO, and in Europe, there exists a 3-kilometer detector, French-Italian detector, which is in Italy, in Pisa, which is VIRGO, and there is a smaller detector in Germany. What is the principle of this big detectors? These are interferometers where essentially you let a very powerful laser light circulate in the two arms of kilometer size interferometer. So there is like 3 kilometers distance between this mirror and this mirror, and the light circulates between these two things and also between these two mirrors. And then you recombine the light coming from these two arms, so you make interferometry. And if a gravitational wave passes by like that, it will like stretch one arm of the interferometer and squeeze the other one and then change the interference pattern. So when you look here, if a gravitational wave passes, you see a change in the fringes. Okay, this is the basic idea. What is the current experimental status of these detectors is they have now reached their design sensitivity, which is the sensitivity for which they were designed for the first generation of detectors, which is a sensitivity where they can detect a gravitational wave, which means a fractional modification in the distance between this mirror 3 kilometers away and this mirror here, of the order of 10 minus 22. Okay, and this is, so it's a very small number. This means, by the way, that the physical change, displacement, is 1,000 times smaller than a Fermi, than the size of a proton, okay? So we are talking about very small displacements. But at this level, nothing has been seen in the last several years. These detectors have been detecting, trying to detect gravitational waves, have been measuring data for a few years, but they have not yet seen any waves. But this is normal when you try to think about the sources that exist, how far they can be, how many sources. This is, at this stage, no problem that nothing has been detected. But because what are the sources of gravitational waves? So I said before that a gravitational wave itself has the structure of it's an object with two indices instead of being an electromagnetic wave, which is a vector, which is transverse to the propagation plane. This is an object with two indices, a tensor, which has a quadrupole structure in the plane transverse to the propagation of the wave. And the wave had this quadrupole structure, but as a consequence, it is emitted also by a quadrupole, okay? It's a quadrupolar type wave, and it is emitted by any moving quadrupole. So if you have any system in nature which is a time-dependent quadrupole, so you have an assembly of masses, and its quadrupole moment changes in time, so if Qij is the quadrupole moment, dot dot is the second time derivative of the quadrupole moment, TT is a transverse traceless projection, so it projects in the orthogonal plane of propagation. Then this formula gives to lowest approximation what is the gravitational waves emitted by this system when you look at it very far in the wave zone. So you see any time-dependent quadrupole moment emits a 1 over r wave. Okay? And what are the gravitational waves we are talking about by LIGO, VIRGO, and their advanced versions? These are essentially binary systems. Okay, there can be stochastic sources coming from the Big Bang. There can be supernova explosion, I mean the implosion of a star. But the problem, for instance, of the implosion of a star is mostly the implosion of a star is spherically symmetric. You have the star falling down on itself with spherical symmetry, and therefore there is no quadrupole moment and no time-dependent quadrupole moment, or a small bit only. Why, if you have a binary system of two black holes or two neutron stars going around and merging, then this has a quadrupole moment. And this is why here you see among sources, no, these are rotating neutron stars, which is something else. But here you have the coalescence, which means the fusion together at the end of their evolution of a binary system made of neutron stars or black holes, okay? And as you see, this amplitude of these waves at a level which is not indicated here, but which is above the level of advanced detectors, because what I'm going to say is the present generation of detectors is just a little bit too insensitive to see anything, but in the coming years we are going to have advanced detectors. These are gravitational waves with typical frequency of the order of 100 hertz, 1000 hertz. This is the type of frequencies we talk about, because the last orbits, they last like a hundredth of a second, okay? So it's the typical frequency for 10 solar mass type black holes, binary black holes. One is also, for the future, hoping that one day there will be a detector of lower frequency gravitational waves, like 10 minus 3 hertz, 10 minus 2 hertz, due to massive black holes or small black holes falling into a big black hole. But this is more for the future. Today we are talking about LIGO-VIRGO type detection. Now, what is the basic principle of detecting gravitational waves? The basic principle is, you have this interferometer, and the interferometer, which is measuring the fractional fringe change, and therefore the fractional length difference, is affected all the time by noise, because you put long arms, and then you have vibrations in the Earth, you have vibration in the optics, you have a frequency change in your laser, you have the mirrors that have pendulum excitations. I mean, you have an innumerable number of sources of noise. And actually, as you have seen, the amplitude of the gravitational waves is so small, 10 minus 2, 10 minus 23. I mean, a change in the position of a mirror of one part in 1,000 of a Fermi, okay, something so small that evidently the broadband noise is larger than what you hope to detect. So the only way you can see a gravitational waves is by knowing in advance what is the shape of the signal you expect, like the signal which was shown on the first transparency, and you will see again a certain signal, like a sine wave emitted by the source. And then this signal, you make a correlation with the noise. For instance, here in the frequency domain, what you do is you take what is called the template, which is the expected signal, what you hope is existing as a source in your output of your detector, and then you make a convolution between the two here in the frequency domain, weighted by the inverse noise, because this is the optimal filter, okay? This is the best way to extract from a noisy output the fact that there is hidden in the noise a wave of a certain shape, okay? But in order to do that, you need to know in advance the shape of the gravitational wave you detect. It's like if you are looking in a broadband noise for a certain frequency, okay, you do a Fourier transform, but you are looking for a certain frequency, okay? And you need to try several frequencies by doing a frequency transform, and then you see if it is present or not. So the question that I'm going now mainly to address is, in order to detect gravitational waves, you need to know in advance what is the precise shape of this gravitational wave. So how do you compute the shape of a gravitational wave? We are talking here about the gravitational waves emitted by binary systems. So this is a space-time diagram. In space-time, a binary system means helix. You have two stars moving around each other, and as you know, if you represent the motion of two stars with time as a vertical direction, it makes an helix. This is a space-time diagram. And then this thing will be emitting gravitational waves. How do you compute the emitted gravitational waves? For this, you have to solve Einstein's equations, which are nonlinear equations where r mu nu is the Ricci tensor of the space-time metric g mu nu, and t mu nu is the source. So there exists a source if you have, for instance, two neutron stars. If you have two neutron stars, you have two blobs of matter that go around, and they source the gravitational wave. Now, if you have two black holes, actually the situation is more subtle because you have no matter, okay? A black hole, there existed matter before, but the matter has disappeared, and you have only two horizons. This is a purely vacuum space-time with just the knowledge that you have some, that there was matter here in the past. Now, how do you do that? This is the question of solving the motion of two bodies in general relativity. This is a problem which has a very long history. It's the first methods, in fact, we don't know, yes, one should say that. You know that in Newtonian theory, you know how to solve exactly the two-body problem, okay? Not only you solve the problem, the Kepler problem of one small planet around a big star, but you can solve two comparable masses going around in elliptic orbit. You can solve it explicitly. Okay, in Einstein theory, you can solve exactly the problem, the one-body problem, which is a small particle moving around one big star, like the sun, okay? Because you can find the exact solution for one body, which is one spherically symmetric body. But you cannot solve exactly the two-body problem where you have of comparable mass that go around. You need approximation methods to do that. And what are the approximation methods you can use? The first one, which is now called post-Minkowskian, was invented by Einstein in 1916, but this is the natural method where you say the space-time metric is flat, the Minkowski space-time, plus a first-order perturbation, and then you can add second-order perturbation. So you make an expansion in deviations from flat space-time, okay. But at the same moment, a young Dutch physicist, a student of Lorentz, invented a new approximation method, which is called post-Newtonian, in which not only you assume that you are talking about a small deviation from flat space-time, but in which you use also the fact that the time derivative of this perturbation is small compared to the space derivative, because the idea is that the time derivative, at least in the near zone, is linked to the velocity with which these two objects move, and if the velocities are smaller compared to the velocity of light, you have a second small parameter. So when you do this, you can use a second small parameter, which is v square over c square, okay, and it helps to solve the thing. Then, as Gian Michele alluded to, when you have to talk about the motion of two black holes, in fact, these methods are not sufficient by themselves because you need to say, but somewhere I have very strong fields, so I need to combine weak field, strong field, okay? And recently, a new method of approximation came along the line, which is numerical relativity, that It's only like 5 years ago that after 30 years of effort, people could use stable codes to compute the motion of two black holes and what are the gravitational waves that they emit. So I'm not going to describe in detail how you do the technical calculations of solving the two-body problem with sufficient approximation, because I will mention later the explicit result. But let me just say that the key word is that you use a cocktail of various methods. That is to say, you use some of usual non-linearity expansion, post-Minkowskian, some post-Newtonian, then you combine them with multi-chart approach, with match asymptotic expansion, effective field theory expansion, and you use all the tools that you find also in quantum field theory. I will explain why, like dimensional regularization, and it's a complicated problem, so you use everything you can, and it works. So, for instance, one way to explain how you do the computations of a two-body interaction is to say you solve Einstein's equation by successive approximation, where between two bodies you exchange one graviton that you could describe by this diagram, and then you have more like nonlinear vertices, so nonlinear effects where you have several gravitons that interact and things like that. So you compute the effective action by some diagrammatic representations, although when you do the calculations, you don't need to use explicitly the diagram. So this is one of the techniques, just to explain. Now, what is the result of that? What can you really hope to compute something useful for experiment? This is the question. So for years, the question was debated because, for instance, people in the group of Kip Thorne in America have been saying for years that if you use usual approximation methods, like post-Newtonian methods, you will be able to describe the motion of two black holes, but only up to a point, because when the two black holes will get too near each other, and this is the most important moment, because this is when they emit the strong gravitational waves you want to detect, the post-Newtonian methods becomes bad because the velocity becomes comparable to the velocity of light. In fact, what happens is when the two black holes go around each other, when they merge, their velocity is essentially like one half the velocity of light. Okay, so you need to go, the small parameter that you had disappeared. And then Kip Thorne and his group said, you don't have an approximation method for the most important moment, which is the coalescence of the two black holes. And therefore, the only way to do that is to use numerical relativity. At the same time, when working with a postdoc, Alessandra Buonanno, we made a different claim. We said, let's invent a new method. And with this new method, we are claiming that we are going to be able to describe by approximation methods, but with special techniques to improve the approximation method, the inspiring motion of the two black holes up to the moment where they merge. And then when they merge, we know a second approximation method to describe what is happening after the merger. I will describe what it is. So we made this claim in 2000, and at the time, and we made the first calculation of a complete waveform. So we said, this is the gravitational wave emitted by a binary system. And it's only in 2005 that numerical relativity succeeded in computing the first waveforms. And as you can see, these waveforms are close to what we were claiming, and I'm going to describe now how close they are actually. But let me explain why the gravitational wave has this structure. So this structure is due to what? You have two black holes that go around each other. For a long time, the black holes are far from each other, so they go slowly around each other, and therefore the gravitational wave it emits is like a sine wave, because it goes around periodically. Okay. But because the system is losing angular momentum and energy to infinity, actually, the system is speeding up because it loses energy, so it gets closer and closer. And when the two objects are closer, they go faster and faster. So you should see a sine wave where the frequency increases. So the things become smaller and smaller frequency, and the amplitude increases because it goes closer and closer and faster. So this explains why during the inspiring motion, you have a wave which is like that. And then at some moment, the two black holes really plunge towards each other, although it does not really happen this way, we will see, and they coalesce, and then they merge, and then there is a ring down waveform, which means you have a maximum intensity, and then the thing decays. Okay, you see it better here. We will describe now in more details how it works. Ah, yes. So now I need to, how do I take away this to show the movie? Because I have a short movie of numerical calculations that last only 10 seconds or so. So it's a movie which has been done by the Albert Einstein Institute group of Luciano Rezzola in Potsdam, in Gölm. Okay, so you are going to see two black holes. These are the last orbits of two black holes going around each other. Yes, let's start. And so initially they go slowly around each other, and then the system will accelerate, and then be careful, you see. So very fast, at some moment, they have merged. And this was extremely fast. And instead of two separated black holes, you have like an oblate black hole, because what happens is the two black holes merge, and then you have a rotating black hole, which is deformed, because but it rotates. So, yes, maybe we can see it again, because it's so short, so that... So this is the inspiring motion. During this motion, it emits gravitational waves like that, a sine wave, and then the sine wave accelerates. So here it goes, although it's not so evident, it goes faster and faster. So in real time, for black holes of 10 solar mass, the last orbit is a hundredth of a second. It's a very short thing. Yes, if you can help me again with this. Now, this is numerical relativity result, which shows the space-time itself, but out of the space-time, you also extract what is the gravitational waves at infinity that we are going to show now. So this is the type of waveform computed by numerical relativity, you see. During the inspiral, you have the sine wave, the amplitude increases, the frequency increases, and then you have the merger of the two black holes. And now the new groups, after a breakthrough due to Pretorius, the new groups, especially the Caltech Cornell CETA group, using a spectral probe, is able to compute this waveform with very high accuracy. Now, so you could say at this level, okay, so now numerical relativity exists, it can compute this very precise waveform. Why do we care about having an analytical method to compute the less thing with less accuracy? There are many reasons why you want an analytical method. First, it's useful to have a theoretical understanding of what happens, especially in the case of spinning black holes, okay? Because when you will have two black holes with spin, you will have more complicated things with precession of the spin, and the physics gets so complicated that you want an analytical formalism to understand what is going on. But what is even more important is that if you ask numerical people, okay, can you compute this waveform? They say yes, but how long will it take for you to compute it? The answer is at least 2 months. And now, how many waveforms do you need? You need 10,000 or 100,000 waveforms, because as I said before, in order to detect gravitational waves, you need to know the possible waveform in advance in order to correlate them with the noise. But for this, as you don't know the parameters of the source, like the two masses, the spins, this means many parameters that you have to scan. You have a multi-dimensional space, like a space of 7 dimensions, and for each point in this space, you need to compute in advance a waveform to stock it somewhere or compute it in real time, and then compute your correlation with the output of your detector. And if it takes 2 months to compute one waveform, evidently you won't be able to do anything. Okay, that's why you really need an analytical method. And what I will now present is that the present method that we have developed, started with Alessandra Bonanno, is called this effective one-body method. I will explain why. And this is an analytical method, but which uses information both from perturbation theory, so you use results from post-Newtonian and other perturbation theory, but you use crucially also information from numerical relativity. Like, because this method cannot really describe what happens in the fully strong field, you use some information from numerical relativity, you use information from analytical relativity, and you combine the two things. So how do you do that? So this method, okay, I just said its name, effective one body, was introduced by us and then developed over the years, okay, and it's still under development, but I will describe what exists today. So let me first describe the essence of the method. So the essence of the method is the following. First, this method describes the full waveform from minus infinity when you have two objects going around each other slowly up to the moment where they merge, and at the end, as you have seen in the movie, there is one black hole, which is the final black hole. And to do it, you do it by saying there are two phases. There is the phase which is the in spiral, when the two objects are separated, and when you do that, you treat the two black holes as two point masses. So there is a first part of the method where you say, I have two black holes described by really point masses, and then at some moment, when these two point masses are so near that they are no longer point masses, you jump and you say, at this point, I say the two black holes merge very fast, and then I can describe the rest of the signal by saying I have one black hole, but this black hole is ringing. Because if you imagine that you have two black holes, like two spheres that touch each other, and then they fuse, they coalesce to make one thing, you say this is like a ringing black hole. A black hole can move and ring like a bell, okay? So you make this coarse approximation by saying there is one moment where you match the two-point masses to a ringing black hole. And we are going to see it works beautifully. At the time when we made this conjecture, it was not clear why it should work, but you have seen on the movie, actually, that the coalescence is very, very fast, okay? So there is nearly like no real transition, no phase transition between the two. And by the way, as here we see on this plot, what you have is the superposition of two waveforms. There is the analytical waveform, I think it is the red one, and then there is the numerical one, which is the black. But as you can see, they are totally superposed from, in fact, minus infinity here, and the only place where you can see a small difference is here, that there is a tiny difference. So this is an example of how the effective one-body analytical method can agree with numerical relativity, okay? And I will describe how this agreement is obtained. But first, let me go back to, so what do you do technically to compute first the perturbation theory of the motion of two masses? So technically, I said you describe the two black holes as being two point masses. But now, I don't know if there are mathematicians in the audience, maybe not. But for a mathematician, it is absurd to assume that Einstein's theory can admit solutions which are point masses, because the theory of delta functions, point masses, is valid only for linear theories. You know, in Maxwell equations, you can put a delta function source if you don't treat self-effects, okay? Why, in Einstein's theory, which is highly nonlinear, you cannot put a delta function, okay? Also, because physically, these objects are not point masses, they are black holes, they are extended objects. But you do it, and you use quantum field theory techniques, which is you use perturbation theory, but you work in a space-time dimension, which is not 4, but 4 plus epsilon, where epsilon is a complex parameter, and you make analytical continuation in epsilon. You know, this is called dimensional continuation, and this avoids and treats very nicely for you all the infinities and regularization effects that you would need to work with if you had point particles. But then you need to do calculations, both at the level of the dynamics, and this has been done over the years by a group of people, at the level which can be described as being 3 loops, in the sense that the type of calculation you do is you have the 2 world lines of the 2 bodies, and then you compute the interaction by gravitational interaction. So, for instance, this diagram means you take into account only the linearized gravity between two objects, okay? This is saying these world lines emit a gravitational field, which is absorbed by the other one, which is the 1 over r Newtonian interaction, okay? While here, it means you have more complicated things where each body creates a gravitational field, and the energy in the gravitational field is creating a secondary gravitational field, which then interacts with itself and then with the other bodies. So these are nonlinear interactions between the two bodies. So you compute this up to diagrams which are 3 loops, 3PN, and you do the same thing for the waves emitted at infinity. So you just do that. I mean, you just do that. It took many years to do that, okay? And here is the result, for instance, for the interacting Hamiltonian, as computed by Yaronovsky, Schaefer, and then I helped them to finish the calculation completely in 2000. So this is the interaction Hamiltonian at the highest level where you can compute everything. At this, the first line here, you can recognize it's the Newtonian interaction. You see P squared over 2m, and then the 1 over r interaction, okay? Then you have the so-called first post-Newtonian correction, which are V squared over C squared correction. And this correction have been first computed by Lorentz and Drost in 1917 and by Einstein in 1938. Then the 2PN calculation was completed at the time of the binary pulsar calculation in 1982 by myself. And then the 3PN was computed only in 2000, okay? So you see, it gets quite complicated. You do the same thing for the waveform, which is the wave emitted at infinity. So I said before that the waveform is essentially a quadrupole formula, okay? If you have a quadrupole moment of the source, you just take two derivatives of the quadrupole moment, and this is the wave. Actually, this is more complicated than this because you have corrections to this. And this is, for instance, the quadrupolar wave. So it needed the work of Luc Blanchet and many others over many years to compute this. So the quadrupole formula is the first term here. It's this one, okay? This is the leading order quadrupole formula. But then you have corrections, 1PN, half PN, 2PN, and up to 3PN and 3.5PN, okay? And you see complicated coefficients and logarithm appearing. By the way, for the following formulas, it's useful to know that we talk about the binary systems with masses M1 and M2, and we denote the total mass by capital M, M1 plus M2, and there is a very important parameter which is called the symmetric mass ratio. It is the product of the two masses divided by the square of the sum of the two masses. This quantity is dimensionless, because it's the ratio of square mass divided by square mass. And this quantity, when one mass is much larger than the other one, is a small parameter. This is the test mass limit, where I have a small particle going around a big one. But when this parameter, when the two masses are equal, this parameter is equal to 1/4. And this is the case where you have no perturbation theory, okay? But still, you are going to use this parameter as a kind of deformation parameter to check that when it is very small, you know the exact answer, and when it is 1/4, you hope that this answer will not be too different from the thing. So I will not, don't be afraid of this. The basic point, so this is the full structure of this effective one-body formalism, but the key word is that for each thing you do, you are going to use resummation methods. Resummation methods means instead of using the result of perturbation theory as they are, so for instance, as they are means you have a formula of this type, where you have 1 plus x squared. So it's like a power expansions in power of x. X means, by the way, v squared over c squared, essentially. So instead of using the result as a power series expansion, 1 plus x squared, you replace it by something else, which is a function of x, which is a better representation of this, up to the same level you know. Okay, and I will give examples on how you do that. So let's start with the dynamics. So the dynamics means the part of the interaction between the two objects that describes the equations of motion and how they go around, even in absence of gravitational radiation back reaction. So I said before that you describe the interacting Hamiltonian by expanding it by some calculations like that. And this means you have the Hamiltonian I have shown, which was this complicated formula, which starts with the Newtonian Hamiltonian, and then you have v square over c square correction, v4 over c4 correction, v6 over c6 corrections. So it's a long and complicated result. And the basic idea of the effective one-body problem is to say, this is really the Hamiltonian for the two-body problem, but I'm going to represent it by a different problem, which is one particle of mass mu, where mu is the usual, you know, effective mass, M1, M2 divided by the sum of the two masses. I want to say that a particle of mass mu moving in some unknown spacetime, in some effective curved background, has a dynamics which is equivalent to this complicated two-body dynamics. So the problem you pose is, can there exist an effective metric? And because this is the effective metric which describes the dynamics of a two-body system, in a two-body system, in absence of spin, this dynamics is isotropic. It does not select special direction in space. So it should be invariant under the group of rotations, the rotations of the relative distance between the two bodies, which means that if this effective metric exists, it should be spherically symmetric. And therefore, It means there should exist two functions of the radial distance, a function A and a function B, such that this effective metric has this form. So already you have reduced your problem to the following one. Can I find two functions A and B such that this effective Hamiltonian, the geodesic motion of one particle in this effective metric, is equivalent to this complicated Hamiltonian? How do you pose this problem? Because what does it mean to say that a one-body problem is equivalent to a two-body problem? To do that, you use an idea that I learned long ago from John Wheeler in Princeton and reading his works. Wheeler always said that classical mechanics can be clarified if you think quantum mechanically. Because the problem I'm talking about is a purely classical problem. These are enormous classical objects. And I'm talking about their classical dynamics. But let us think quantum mechanically. Instead of saying I have a two-body classical system, I say I have a two-body quantum system. And then this means this is a certain level spectrum. I have energy levels, and I know by opening a book of quantum mechanics that these energy levels will be classified by the quantum numbers appropriate for a spherical asymmetric problem, which is the like SPDF states, etc. I have the quantum number L. I have also the magnetic quantum number M, which is the Z component of angular momentum that does not show because I have a degeneracy with respect to M. And then I should have a radial quantum number N. And I know that in the Coulomb problem, I have a degeneracy between N and L, but not in a relativistic problem. So I know that I would have real quantum states like that, bound states. So these are the bound states of a two-body system viewed quantum mechanically. If I treat now one effective particle in an external spherically symmetric field, I will have also bound states. So something like that, that I can compute from the function A and B. And now what you ask is that there is a map which makes is one-to-one between these two energy levels, okay? And although it seems to say nearly nothing, it says a lot, because it says that each quantum state here is mapped to one quantum state, each quantum state is mapped to one quantum state. And when you convert this diagram in equations, what you find is, using the old Sommerfeld quantization of quantum mechanics, which is that what determines the quantum numbers are the adiabatic invariants, the integral PdQ over the degrees of freedom, you know, the Bohr-Sommerfeld thing. What this diagram is saying is that finally, the classical Hamiltonian, if you re-express the classical Hamiltonian in terms of the integrals, how they are called, the action integrals, integral of PdQ, and in classical mechanics, this is called the Delaunay Hamiltonian, okay? So you compute the Delaunay Hamiltonian of the real problem, two-body problem, the Delaunay Hamiltonian of the effective problem, and you say the two Hamiltonians are the same modulo a certain function that transform them, okay? It looks like nothing, but it is actually a very strong requirement. And when you require this, you find there is a unique solution, essentially. And not only that, but first you find that the energy states are changed, because I said before that I am not requiring that the energy in the two-body rest frame is equal to the energy of the effective problem, because you realize the effective problem is like in a moving frame in some sense, so there is some transformation that you don't know in advance. But when you do the computation, you find a very simple answer, which is that the effective energy is simply equal to the square of the real two-body energy, so it's the Mandelstam invariant S, and you have this exact formula that you find, okay, out of the comparison. So, but when you pursue it, and then you say, the next step is I compute what are the coefficients of the effective metric, the A and B coefficients, where I remind you that A is the coefficient of the dt squared. So, as you know, probably, in general relativity, the coefficient of dt squared, the curvature of space-time associated to the measurement of clocks, of time, is linked to the gravitational potential, the Newtonian potential. And for a usual isolated body, like, let's say, the sun, G00, this component, A, is equal to 1 minus 2 gm over c squared r. This is one of the basic formulas. The potential around the sun is 1 minus 2 gm over c squared r for this A component. But what you find when you do now not a one-body problem but a two-body problem is, if I denote the combination gm over c squared r simply by u to simplify, I know that in the limit where one body is much smaller than the other one, I should get 1 minus 2u, which is the Schwarzschild solution, 1 minus 2gm over c squared. I get extra corrections, which starts at u cube and then at u4. But what I find really remarkable is that, you see, I was solving only for two functions here, a and b, and the result is very simple. For instance, the most important function is this thing because it's like the interaction potential between the two bodies. It's what replaces the usual 1 over r potential. But the answer is 1 minus 2u is fully contained here. But this answer is equivalent to this complicated thing. So you see, here I have 100 terms, and I don't know what to do with them because when the next term becomes large, it messes up the full thing. It means the theory, I cannot use this Hamiltonian. Why here, when, sorry, I have to go back. Here, I have this very simple formula, and for instance, at 2pn, at 1pn, I have no corrections, so the answer is zero. At 2pn, I have only a coefficient 2 to compute, and I mean, you need to compute the 100 coefficients before in order to find it is 2, the final answer. And at the next level, all the complication is contained in this number, which is this, 94 over 3 minus 41 over 32 pi squared. Okay. This is the final important number you get. And then this gives an Hamiltonian, which describes the two-motion system, instead of this. So this Hamiltonian I've just described, which is quite simple, so which compactifies the very complicated information about the two-body interaction in one simple thing, describes the orbits between the two objects. But it describes the orbits when I neglect gravitational radiation damping, okay? So for instance, it defines an effective potential, which is the Hamiltonian for a given angular momentum as a function of the radial distance. And when this effective potential has this shape, this is saying that I can have elliptic orbits. You see, if I have a fixed energy, let's say at the level a little bit below one, which means bound system, I will have the particle which goes from radius here to this radius and then back here. That will be an elliptic orbit, okay? If I sit for one angular momentum here at the minimum of this effective potential, then I have a circular orbit. So the Hamiltonian I describe describes the conservative dynamics of the system. And then at some level, when the angular momentum gets too small, you see that you don't have a centrifugal barrier because I should say that in the Newtonian approximation, this curve is simply, you know, L square over 2R square, the centrifugal barrier, and then minus 1 over R, which is the gravitational potential. And as we know, it is the competition between the centrifugal barrier and the 1 over R attraction, which makes the existence of Keplerian orbits. Okay. So you have a modification of this with the fact that the centrifugal barrier goes to zero at some radius which corresponds to the horizon, okay, in the usual Schwarzschild case. So, this Hamiltonian describes the conservative dynamics. But now you need to describe the fact that the system is losing energy and angular momentum. So you need to add something to the formalism. The way you add it is you write Hamilton's equations. So these are Hamilton's equations. But you add on the right-hand side of some of them an extra force, which is a damping force. In particular, the usual Hamilton equation would say that P phi, which is the angular momentum, is conserved. Okay, under a conservative evolution. But here, you want to say angular momentum is lost to gravitational waves. So on the right-hand side, you put a certain object, f of phi, which expresses the loss of angular momentum. But how do you compute this loss? Before, I said you have a formula for this loss, which is a certain expanded, Taylor expanded formula. You replace this by a resummed expression. So I won't describe, go into the detail, but here you use also new techniques, like you resum an infinite number of leading logarithms, you solve auxiliary problems, you think about the problem for a while, and then you come up with some explicit formulas. And these explicit formulas then give you a resum formula for the radiation reaction force that you put on the right-hand side, which still contains things which are not resummed, because you find that they are good enough now in order that you don't need to resum them. You do some studies of this. So it gives an explicit analytical representation, and then you test this analytic representation against some numerical calculation. I will not spend too much time on this, but this is, if you were using a Taylor expanded representation of gravitational radiation reaction, you would get something that at 1 pn is here, at 2 pn is here, and you need to go to very high orders to get close to the good answer, which is the solid line. Why, if you use the new method, you are exactly on top of the numerical answer without doing anything, okay? And the same thing is true when you compare to numerical relativity for the two black hole problem, but I will enter with that. So these methods, they started from perturbation theory, and then they used some new ideas and new resummation methods. But still, by themselves, they would not have a perfect agreement with numerical relativity, because what you have used in the analytical calculation is calculations up to the third approximation order. But you know there are corrections beyond the third approximation order. And how are you going to get some information about it? The way you do now is you say, for instance, I've computed the function A, which is really the gravitational potential of attraction between two objects, to some order of approximation in U. It was 1 minus 2U plus 2 nu U cube plus A4 U4. But you know there are terms beyond that, terms of order U5, of order U6, etc. You don't know them. It's too difficult now to compute them, although a big effort in principle could allow to compute them. But what you do is you say, okay, let's assume they exist. I don't know them. I put them as three parameters. Let me resum this thing, because this is an expansion 1 minus 2u plus, which is not good to use as a Taylor expansion. So I transform it in a Padé approximant, which means I write it as the ratio of two polynomials. And then what you do is you look for values of these parameters that agree well with numerical relativity. So at this stage, you use numerical relativity results, and you try to find what are the good values of these uncalculated parameters so you have a good agreement with numerical relativity. So here you have a complementarity between numerical relativity and analytical relativity. And this is when you do that you have the beautiful results I was mentioning before, because on this plot, you have the superposition, as I said, of a numerical relativity waveform and the effective one-body waveform, but for values of these parameters that you have tuned in order to agree with the result. So here you use numerical relativity. But look that the tuning is not, you know, very sharp. For instance, these numbers are 0 and minus 20. They are not minus 19.2534 and things like that. I mean, you don't need to tune many numbers. You find things and then it works. Okay, and as I said before, the agreement is so good that during all the time you see no difference except here where there is a small difference. Okay, here I've been talking mainly about the work we have done at IHES with recently my postdoctoral student Alessandro Nagar. I should say that parallelly to what we were doing in France, my former postdoc, Alessandra Buonanno, who is now in America, has been working also independently and parallelly with her students on and has developed also the effective one body and obtained results comparable in quality. These are specific results that she obtained for several mass ratios, you know. So this shows that effective one body can beautifully agree with numerical relativity. Let me, by the way, give you an explicit result. So this is the function A that I mentioned. This is this function that in lowest approximation, this function should be the Schwarzschild value, 1 minus 2m over r. That is to say, as a function of u, which is m over r, should be the straight line 1 minus 2u, which is this straight line. And if you do analytical calculation of this function, you get at the 1 pn approximation, you get 1 minus 2u, which is this straight line. If you use the 2 pn approximation, you get this curve here, which is a little bit above 1 pn. And this is what we knew in 1999, okay? Then in 2000, we could compute the 3 pn approximation, and then you get this thing. But you see that the 3 pn approximation is so different from the 2 pn approximation in the strong field regime, because this value U means 0.5, but 0.5 is the value which is the horizon for a Schwarzschild black hole. So it means the two black holes touch each other, you know, really. Okay. So it's normal that in the strong field you have the next order is different from the previous order. But still, this difference is so large that you don't like this. So at the time we said, let's use the Padé resummation of the 3 pn, and this gave this black curve here. And now, after years of using numerical relativity to improve effective one body, the curve you get, the best curve you get, is the red curve. This is the latest curve we obtained like last month with Alessandro Naga using the best numerical relativity. And you see that, so you have learned numerical relativity is telling you the truth is around this thing. But the analytical guess we had made before was not very far from it, okay? So this is why analytical methods can by themselves be useful. Let me also mention here, I was talking about the gravitational wave emitted by a binary black hole, but one could do other comparisons. Like for instance, last year with numerical people, we did the following thing. We took a binary system of two black holes, computed in numerical relativity, and this binary system is emitting energy and angular momentum to infinity. But what you do is, before the system starts emitting, you know what is the initial energy and the initial angular momentum of the binary system. You take away, you subtract the emitted energy and angular momentum, and this gives you the relation between the energy and the angular momentum for a binary system which is along a circular, I mean, a sequence of circular orbit. It is in spiraling, but essentially along circular orbit. And numerically, you get this black curve, okay? This curve which is here. But when you ask what is the prediction from effective one-body, even the effective one-body method of 2000, not knowing anything about numerical relativity, you get the red curve. And you see that the red curve is extremely close to the numerical one and stay close to it up to the end. Why, if you use perturbation theory in this form, you have the dashed curve, which is visibly different from that. So it's one example where analytical methods really can describe. There is also work of Lethiec et al. Where they did a comparison between effective one-body and the precession of like the Mercury precession, but for binary black holes, and they got also, I don't want to describe, that the effective one-body is very close to numerical relativity. I should say that one of the big motivations for this work is to go beyond what I have described up to now, which is the motion of non-spinning binary black holes, two black holes which are not spinning, but to go to the full system of spinning black holes. But this is something which is now being developed. The theory has been developed for years. And in America, the first comparison have been done by Alessandra Buonanno and her group. And then the preliminary results they got using too much tuning for my taste, but still it works, that you can, using the effective one-body and spin effects, a good agreement with some numerical relativity things, but probably not with all existing numerical relativity waveforms. So this is preliminary but promising. I don't have the time to mention that there is also the question of neutron stars, because binary black holes, we are not absolutely sure that they exist in nature. I mean, we think they exist, but you have not observed binary black holes of 10 solar mass each. Why you are sure they exist, binary system of neutron stars, because these are binary pulsars, for instance. And it's very important to extend the effective one-body to the case of binary neutron stars, and you can. You use the same formalism, but you need to take into account that neutron stars can be tidally deformed. When two neutron stars are close to each other, there are tidal interactions. That you can describe by adding new non-minimal world line couplings to the Hamiltonian, okay? So, and then you use numerical relativity to determine some, these tidal coefficients, because you can compute them actually, but you need some corrections to them. And it seems to work to a good extent. So let me conclude, because my time is up. So I forgot to say, yes, but now let me say it, that experimentally, what I said at the beginning, LIGO, VIRGO, is the detectors exist today, okay. But now they are being upgraded. That is to say, the detectors actually are stopped, and they are improving the detection system to gain a factor 10. And in a few years, which means in 2-3 years, in 2015, 2016, the detectors will have been upgraded and will have a factor 10 improvement in sensitivity. But a factor 10 improvement in amplitude sensitivity means you can see sources 10 times farther in the universe, which means you have a volume 1,000 times bigger, which means you should see 1,000 more sources. And at this level, you should see, like every month, coalescing binary neutron stars or coalescing binary black holes, okay? So this is really in 2016 that you should hear about the detection of gravitational waves. And then there are also other groups in the world, in Japan and in India, that are now creating new gravitational wave detectors. I said that the breakthrough in numerical relativity have been very important in giving us information about really what happens at the coalescence of two black holes. But I also said that by themselves, although they bring us essential non-perturbative information, you still need to have a method based on analytical methods, like the effective one-body, because this allows, with the special improvement I mentioned, to describe the full coalescence process, including when the two black holes coalesce. And one should not say that there is a competition between numerical relativity and analytical relativity, but on the contrary, there exists a complementarity. That is to say, the people work together, or at least it took some years that they gave us access to their data, but now we have access to their data. So there is now a good complementarity. The numerical people give their waveforms to analytical people, and then you can improve the analytical methods by tuning, essentially, some parameters that you cannot compute because it's too complicated to compute, and you find a value that works well in a few cases, and then you hope that your analytical NR improve analytical formalism will describe all possible waveforms, which is still to be proven in the sense that analytical methods can predict things, but until we have detected them all, we are not sure that they are the good waveforms. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your talk. Are there questions?
But here you have to think in frequency space, you know. The coalescence takes a hundredth of a second. So if you have perturbations which have the same frequency, you need to worry about them. If this is a slow change due to some environmental change, you don't care. In the frequency band of 100 hertz, you will see nothing. But here, okay, if you are not close to merger, you won't see anything, yeah. I should say the orders of magnitude is that in order to see even 10 solar mass black holes around each other, they need to go to a fraction to the velocity of light. If they are farther apart, the signal is so weak you don't see anything. So you see only like the last 3 minutes, you know. In the last 3 minutes, they go through 1,000 orbits or whatever, and then the frequency increases from 10 hertz to 100 hertz. All that is 3 minutes, and that's it. What happens when they're very far apart, you don't see them here. Maybe in LISA-type detectors, you want to worry about what happens, you know, with long eccentric orbits and things like that. Here I'm talking about LIGO-VIRGO. It's a simpler problem in a sense.
Gianni?
Yes. Yes.
Why were they built in the beginning at specifications at all? Was there another hole?
First, you did not know the statistics. So from the beginning, they have been honest in saying, they always said that initial LIGO was not supposed to see something for sure. Okay? They have been very honest in saying there is no guarantee that at the level of h equal 10 minus 22, which is very impressive, first they had to show you can reach with a stable laser system interferometric thing, 3 kilometers, this sensitivity, okay? But they always said, at this level, if there exists more binary black holes of 10 solar mass than we can estimate, then we should see something, but if they are not so numerous, we won't see, okay? So the only thing they could say is that if there is a source within like 200 megaparsecs of a binary black hole of 10 solar mass, they should have seen it. They did not see any. But it's not a big problem because we are not sure. In fact, we are not even sure that with a factor 1,000, you will see binary black holes, because it's very difficult to estimate how many binary black holes exist. What is more sure is for neutron stars, because you know how many binary pulsars exist, so you can make, although it's a small number of statistics, you can make an estimate in this volume of how many binary neutron stars coalescing you should see. And in that case, you should see between like 1 and 300 events per year. But there is a big uncertainty even for binary neutron stars. But 30 per year is like a medium number, okay.
Question up there.
Yes. No, it's a good question. So there are several measurements of the level of agreement between an analytical waveform and a numerical waveform. So there are several measurements. One of them is the maximum overlap, and then it has to be. And now, what is how many digits you need in this thing? First, I should say that the type of results we have are already too good in the sense that they are better than what you need, but for when the signal-to-noise ratio, the first detection will have a signal-to-noise ratio of 7 or maybe 8, 10, something like that. At this level, they are too good, okay. But later, when the signal-to-noise ratio gets better, you want waveform as accurate as what I said. Anyway, there exists a precise answer, and one can ask for each frequency band and each mass, what is the accuracy of the waveforms that you need, okay. And we are there, so.
Niklas?
Yes. Okay. Yes, so the physical reason, first, the I did not have the time to explain. The ring down is due to the fact that when the two black holes coalesce, very quickly, they instead of two black holes like that, they form one deformed black hole. And you know from the theory that when you start from one deformed black hole, it will oscillate and radiate a lot of energy and go to a curved black hole. This is very fast. Much faster than before. And this explains why the last signal decays exponentially, and you can compute this exponential decay. Now, but the reason also why the waveform I showed are particularly simple, these are without spins, okay? So you have the two objects going around, although there is the full merger. In the merger, not much happened. It's a very fast process. We conjecture it, and it is true. Now, with spin, things are more complicated because the spin precesses, so the waveform as more complicated things. But even in this case, for most cases, the coalescence is also like as simple as that, because at the last moment, although I have two spinning black holes and what happens is a very complicated, you know, whirlpool and things like that, when they merge, not much happens, and you have the ring down waveforms due to a curved black hole, which is near extreme spin. But finally, the people that were afraid saying we will get very complicated, you know, nonlinear dynamics, Einstein chaos or whatever, this did not happen. Maybe there is a corner of parameters where you will have more strong field dynamics, but it seems the horizon, because what happens is when the two black holes nearly touch each other, there appear an horizon around them, which then screens all the complicated physics there. And then all that is, and you just have like a myopic view of what happens at infinity, okay. If you were looking locally at the curvature in between the two black holes, you would see more chaotic and complicated things, but not in the waveform at infinity. Sorry, about... In fact, there is a lot, because even for the non-spinning case, the total energy you emit in the entire process is 5% of the total mass. So although it does not look like 90%, this is still a lot. And in the case of maximum spin, when people numerical calculation of extreme spins, parallel spins, then they found you get 10%, but never more than that, okay? I don't know. Indeed, from the analytical point of view, you jump from one description to another, very discrete. So when you join them, I said phase transition. I should maybe not have said phase transition. But it's something, the matching between the two is very fast. It's like also, you know, these things that happen in string theory and super young Mills, where you have a perturbative description in the weak G regime and in the strong coupling regime, and finally you have a factor 3/4 of change of the entropy between the two. And if you use perturbation theory in one side and perturbation theory on the other side, they join things. So though there is a lot of complicated physics to join the two, perturbation theory on both sides say that nothing happens at the transition. This is, so it's not really indeed a transition where a lot of things happen. It's a matching.
Isn't that surprising
that there is no characteristic? But here, yes. Also, you don't have the time. I mean, it's not that you are going to have like a glue ball that exists for an infinite time. I mean, a gravitational type glue ball. The thing is emitting is losing so much energy also that and when you have when you coalesce you go to the equilibrium state very fast. You have ringing modes, which means you have decaying modes, so from the analytical point of view you don't have the time to stop on the transition and see some complicated physics. Maybe it's not a good answer. Maybe, okay, as I said, if you maybe you sit before in the movie, you saw that at some moment the two horizons merge, okay. So maybe if you look at the space-time geometry locally in the middle of this thing, maybe here you have chaotic things that take place on short time scale and which are very important, okay. But you have to remember that the wavelength, the gravitational wavelength, is always bigger than the system, okay? These are long gravitational waves. So you have a myopic view. You don't see the wave itself, as a wavelength bigger than the size of the system. So you don't see details. So even if you have complicated microscopic phenomena, they are smoothed out in the waveform at infinity. So it's another reason why, from the waveform point of view, you don't see the complicated physics. Okay. Maybe. Not yet observational data, yes.
Can it be done on stored data, or does it have to be done on real time?
That's a good question, and it's not clear what the... they want to do it in real time. And also, it seems that one is reaching the limit of the computing capabilities, because I thought, for instance, that our analytical waveforms, they can be computed now. It takes 1 second to compute one waveform. So you can do 10,000 waveforms in 10,000 seconds. But they seem to want to compute them in real time. And then in real time, it takes too much time, 1 second. So they want. It's not clear how they are going to do the data analysis. I did not work those times on the data analysis. I know they have computer facility problems. They are exceeding the limits of what you can do in real time to analyze the data online, you know, and know whether there is a signal there or not. But I don't know the precise answer.
There is one more question.
Yeah, follow up on that. I was just wondering, the reason that they're computing this in real time is because they're doing some active feedback?
That there is some what, sorry?
They're doing some active feedback on their system?
They want to do it also in real time to have an alert towards astrophysics, because, for instance, you know, they want if there is a gamma ray which is observed first to look specially, and if they see a gravitational wave, to tell the gamma ray burst people to look for some. So they want not only to wait 1 year to say, ah, we had a source that day, and then nobody looked at that. But I'm not sure, because they look at many sources at the same time, so. Yes.
It sounds like all curves are generic, look sort of the same. On the other hand,
yes.
You explain that we have 10,000 different curves. So, is the fine detail?
Yes, it's a fine detail. It's linked to the question of the young lady that you need. But let me explain the big reason. The big reason is in the number of, it goes. Is, for instance, one of these waveforms. Is the reason why you can see something is because you are going to overlap. So you have to imagine that your detector output is noise, okay? And in order to extract the signal from the noise, you need to keep to be in phase for 100 cycles more than this, okay? Because if you are out of phase, then you don't accumulate things, because when you do the correlation, you have zero instead of being always plus one, you need. And because of this, you need that, although it looks like very simple, let's say it's a sine wave which is chirping a little bit, but the acceleration, the way the frequency increases with the number of cycles has to be correctly described to a very small fraction of a radian. Like, you need to not lose a tenth of a radian over 1,000 cycles, okay? So it is an accuracy of 10 minus 3, 10 minus 4 on the parameters of the signal and things like that. And because of this, when you change the mass ratio, you change this proportionally to the change in the mass ratio, you need like 1,000 templates for different mass ratio, and then 100 templates where you put the spin with this value and this value, and then when you multiply 1,000 by 100, you end up with 10,000 templates. Although, I agree with you, it looks a bit stupid to say that, but still, and except if you can represent this by better formula. Here, this formalism works well, but it gives you ODEs that you still have to integrate, because it gives you Hamilton's equations. So that's why it takes 1 second to compute 1,000 orbits, okay? If you could represent it by just an analytical formula, by putting maybe many parameters and things like that, that you could analytically compute, then it would be much faster. But it's like a second stage, maybe.
Okay, so finally, we come to a close, and let's thank Thibault once more.